Good evening and welcome into the Capital Center. A 5 o'clock start for us tonight, but it's a special night here at the Capital Center as a doubleheader of basketball action is headed your way. And the rival Otterbein Cardinals are in town for both the women's and men's games tonight here at the Capital Center. We will also be honoring the 1994-1995 Capital women's basketball team, which finished the season 33-0 en route to their second consecutive national championship. So a very special night indeed in store for us here at the Capital Center. I'm Jay Bloomfield. Thanks for tuning in, and thank you for joining us to bring in the Freshies pregame show. Freshies, healthy, fast, casual food that's good for the body and soul. Reminder, Capital students get 10% off at Freshies. Eat energized. Well, as I mentioned, the Cardinals are in town, and on the women's side, come in with identical records. Both teams 10-8 and 5-6 in OAC play, and we'll have a full update for you of the OAC standings here in just a minute. And a lot of the scores are already in the books because, you know, most games start at 3 o'clock typically on Saturdays. A little bit of a special night here for Capitals, so we have the benefit of knowing pretty much every game before ours and can really set the stage for what this game means in terms of standings. But entering the day, there were four teams in the OAC at 5-6, which is a big deal because that fourth spot is currently one of these 5-6 teams. And that fourth spot, of course, means you get a home game in the first round of the OAC tournament. So lots to play for here over the last month of the season as we have turned the calendar over to February today on the 1st. And Capital in the middle of a huge homestand in which they have four of their next five here at home. And four of the seven games in February will be at home. They also had the game at home their last time out against Muskingum. Capital won that one 91-64. We'll talk a little bit about that as well. And to set up the rest of the show, we will go through the first matchup with Otterbein and talk about what that has to bear on this game here at the Capital Center today. In our Coach's Corner segment, a little bit of a special Coach's Corner as we sat down with assistant coach Jill White. Jill was a member of the 1995 championship team, and we got a little bit of her insight on that as well as her insight on the game here today. So that's what's in store for us on the Freshies pregame show. We'll take a quick break. When we come back, we will dive into today's OAC scores across the state of Ohio.
Lunch, the most unappreciated meal of the day, which is why we at Freshie are screaming from the rooftops, let there be lunch. And no, not a sad sandwich at your desk. We're talking a flavorful Tex-Mex burrito after a brisk walk, or a nutritious Kale Caesar with your work bestie. So let's do our minds, bodies, and taste buds a favor, and let there be lunch. Download the game-changing new Freshie app to have your food ready, or order at Freshie.com.
Where will you live your purpose? Not in a refuge from the real world. The university anchored in the center of Ohio is at the epicenter of possibility, purpose, and the power of purple. There's no time for hesitation here. No need to put things neatly in their boxes. Just the need to nurture the role you were born for, no matter who you are. We believe that engagement is as important as education, that curiosity is as important as the classroom. And when given the chance, we do more, not less. We live, learn, and lead with purpose, just like the city that surrounds us. We're a coalition of the willing, an alliance of the ready, a union of the good. We're from Capital, and our purpose is purpose.
And welcome back to the Freshies pregame show. It's time to jump into the OAC update brought to you by Capital Army ROTC. Well, as I mentioned, a lot of games in action here in the OAC today, already pretty much at the ends of all of these games. We have a couple of winners to report and some others that are coming down to the final seconds, it looks like. So we'll start with the games that are going to be with the winners decided, and it's the two teams that entered the day at 10-1. Baldwin Wallace has no problems at home with Muskingum. They're up 81-52 with 2 minutes left in the fourth quarter of play there, so pretty safe to say that they will come away with that victory. And then John Carroll also in a comfortable spot, up 72-46 all over Marietta on the road. That's a pretty good win, to say the least. Both those teams, again, were 10-1, so the top place in the OAC is going to be at 11-1, and it's all but sure that one of those two teams will be the regular season champion here in the OAC. And how about this? We have an upset to report, which is also fantastic news for Capital in terms of the standings. Wilmington, entering the day at 5-6, has lost to Heidelberg at home, as Heidelberg is up by 5 with 2 seconds left, 71-66, the current score. And a huge win for Heidelberg to stay in the running to get a spot in the OAC tournament. They entered the day 2 games back of the final spot against Mount Union, who is also currently losing. Mount Union is down 68-61 with 25 seconds left. So if we go ahead and give Ohio Northern the win, this was a pretty perfect day for Capital. Every team behind Capital, besides Heidelberg, lost today. Every team in front of them won. So at this point, you want the top three teams to pretty much just run away with it, and Capital can make a move for that fourth spot. If they win today's game, they would still only be 3 games back of Ohio Northern, but they don't get to play the Polar Bears again. They split the season series and would be a tough climb to get back into the running with Ohio Northern for that 3 spot. They'll need a lot of help from teams that are behind them in the standings. So other than that, though, Marietta and Wilmington were both 5-6. They're now both 5-7, and Mount Union dropped to 4-8. So what this means is the winner of today's game will have sole possession of the number 4 seed at 6-6. The loser, still not in a horrible spot, they would be just in 5th place, 1 game back of 4th, and tied with 2 other teams for that 5th spot. That would be the downside. And more kind of on the line for Capital in this matchup due to the fact that they did not win the first matchup. If Capital loses today, they would lose the tiebreaker with Otterbein for the season series. So instead of being just 1 game back of that 4th spot, they'd actually in effect be 2 games back, because they'd have to have a better record than Otterbein to pass them, unless of course there's a 3-way tie scenario. The scenarios will obviously sort themselves out as we go through the rest of the season, but for now, let's just say, being this a home game for Capital, we didn't really need to add any more pressure to them or anything like that, but this is a huge game, and they have more on the line today than does Otterbein, being at home, trying to protect their home floor, and trying to even up this season series, more importantly, with the Cardinals. That's our OAC update. And again, we won't have any scores to pass along during today's game, so it'll be all about the game here. And we'll see what that brings to the table for next week. Capital has Marietta and John Carroll on the schedule for next week. So another big one once again on Wednesday. And at this point of the season, you could say they're all big, to say the least. Let's go to the Capital Countdown now. This is brought to you by On the Border Mexican Grill and Cantina. A review of the game from Wednesday. Not much to really go over in this one. Capital completely dominated this game. In the first 3 quarters, they outscored Muskingum 27-8, 22-14, and 26-18. In the first quarter alone, Muskingum shot 3 for 16 and had 4 turnovers. They had 2 players score in the first quarter. They finally got a little bit more offensive contributions throughout the game, but a very slow start for Muskingum. Capital starters didn't have to play much at all. Cassidy Bosch played 19 minutes. Ellie Watchman only played 14 minutes. Stonerock played 19 minutes. Burns played 18 minutes, and they all hit double figures. 12 points apiece for Stonerock and Burns, 11 for Watchman, and 14 for Bosch, who led all scores for Capital, that is. Capital's bench also got involved. Erica Linder and Brooke Almert each played 14 minutes off the bench. Kaylee Cyphers played 12 minutes and had 11 points and 7 rebounds. Jossie Kaiser had a big third quarter. She had 8 points, knocking in 2 triples. 5 points from Gabby Ledbetter in the last few minutes as well. Nancy Siegel was able to get 5 minutes and put up 4 points in that time as well. So just contributions up and down the team roster. Everybody played in the game that's on the Capital roster. every 12 players scored that saw the floor. And again, all five players had double figures, four of them in that starting lineup. Taphorn did not have double figures, but she did have 6 points, three steals, a block, eight rebounds, and seven assists. So obviously had an impact as well. She only played 25 minutes and likely could have had a shot at a triple-double, honestly, if she played another 10 minutes. But you're not going to run her out for 35 minutes in a game that was already decided by about midway through the third quarter. So Capital took care of business here at home. They pushed Muskingum to 1-10, who's now 1-11. And Capital moved to 5-6 with the victory, which sets up the game here with Otterbein today. We'll take another time out when we come back. Our Coach's Corner interview with assistant coach Jill White. And we'll set the table for today's matchup with the Otterbein Cardinals. We'll be right back.
OSU Sports Medicine is a proud supporter of Crusader student athletes by providing sports health services for Capital University athletics and student health services. Through the work and care of team physicians and athletic trainers, it's the team behind your team. For all fans, if you're looking to improve your physical performance, recover from an injury, or stay active for a lifetime, the experts at Ohio State Sports Medicine are there for you. Visit sportsmedicine.osu.edu or call 366-4332.
And welcome back to the Capital Center. Again, it's time for our Coach's Corner. We sat down with 1998 All-American Jill White, who was a freshman member of the 95 championship team, which will be honored in between the women's and men's games here at the Capital Center today. And that interview, again, brought to you by Planks Cafe and Pizzeria. Here's the interview with Jill. All right, a special treat today. We're catching up with Jill White, assistant coach, first year here at Capital, member of the 95 championship team. And obviously, you guys are having the reunion today, kind of a special day for you guys as well. And just wanted to touch a little bit base on, you know, just kind of reflecting back on that team. You know, everyone's going to be back tonight. And my first question is about being the team that had a target on your guys' back going into that year, winning the championship the year before. When did you guys know that you can put it together and do it again? And, you know, also just be undefeated as well. You have that to worry about all season long. Were there any kind of moments in that season where something just clicked and you thought it was going to happen again? Or kind of take us through that year,
yeah,
if you could.
Well, we'll start with great senior leadership. We had really good seniors that year that kind of had the experience. A lot of kids back, actually, that had the experience from the national championship. And I think it started with the example that they set for myself and the rest of the freshmen about what Capital basketball was all about, and they held us accountable. I don't know that there was a time that any of us really felt like that was the end goal, and I think that's the beauty of Coach, is she keeps you on task every day, and no matter how many points we won by, no matter what the score was, it was always, we can do better, we got to be better, and we got to keep pushing to get better.
My next question was actually about Dixie. You know, 25 years later, you're on the sideline with her now. Anything different about the way she coaches, or has it just kind of been the same message from her when you were a player as well, being alongside that?
I think the message is the same. Play hard, play for each other, play together. But I think, as with any of us, we all, as we, you know, she was obviously mature, but as we get older, you know, we learn. You learn from every experience, and you change a little bit, you grow a little bit, and you get a little bit better, and so that's one of the reasons I wanted to come back, is just the opportunity to be around her again and be on the sideline with her.
Let's talk about Otterbein, obviously a huge rival for us here. Can you take us back to the mid-90s and take us through that rivalry then and kind of how it compares to now? And
yeah,
I'm sure it's more of the same, but
Coach always gives me a hard time because I don't remember any specifics of any games. you know, I think this is what I would always tell the kids that I would coach in middle school, like, you're going to forget the games, you're going to remember each other. And so those are the things, those memories that we had together that I think I focus on more. I can pick a few games out. Obviously, I think when we play men, women together, I think that adds a little bit of excitement for everybody. But, you know, I think we were just to the point where next team up and let's go get them.
Let's talk about this 2020 group. Dixie's been saying when we interview here that it looks like, you know, you guys still have this team that can make a run here. You guys have a lot of close losses this year. And here we are, we're sitting at 5-6, but we're tied for fourth right now and can still very well catch that three seed as well.
you know, what's the message coming from your experience level being on a team that's won a championship? How do you bring that into the table as well to these girls? And, you know, what can we do to get to that next step and put a little run together here?
Yeah, I think I told Coach the other day when we were in here talking after a game, we're not losing games on game days. We're losing games on Thursday and Friday. And so I think that's the message for the girls, is preparing every day to be successful for the game 2 days from now, 3 days from now. We have to have a little more attention to detail in practice. I think that's going to make the difference.
And usually I wrap these up by asking Dixie her biggest key to the game. So I'll ask you today, what's the biggest key to beating Otterbein today and even up the season series with them?
I think ball pressure is going to be huge for us today. And I think just taking care of the ball too. Executing on offense and taking care of the ball.
Dixie liked that answer to my left here, so I guess we'll call that a winning answer there. So thanks for joining us. Congratulations as well. And, you know, we're excited for the ceremony in between games and hope you can really take it in and enjoy that.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Jill.
Thanks again to our assistant coach Jill White for helping us out in our pregame interview. Coach's Corner brought to you by Planks Cafe and Pizzeria. And some interesting insight there from assistant coach Jill White. And Dixie was in there, nodding her head along with a lot of the answers that Jill was giving us in Dixie's office before the game here today. So, again, thanks to both for allowing us some access there. Let's get to our breakdown of today's game now. We call this segment Setting the Table, brought to you by Pepsi, Live for Now. And going back to that first game, I don't think there's a whole lot to go over from this first game with Otterbein. The reason why Capital was pretty shorthanded in that game, they did not have Reagan Stonerock healthy for that game. Caroline Taphorn did not play in that game. And Ellie Watchman played 7 minutes. She was not in foul trouble or anything. They just were trying to work her back in. This game took place back on December 7th. It was the very first game in conference play, and it was the fifth game of the season. So much different team today than we have coming back to that matchup back on December 7th. For Otterbein, it looks like more of the same. They still have the same projected starting lineup as they did in that game. The one change might be Bryn Mangold being a little bit more of a bigger player for them than Kathleen DiCarlo, who got the start in the first matchup. DiCarlo was injured as well. She started all 9 games that she's played this season and has not played since. Bryn Mangold has stepped in to fill that void. And Delaney Cuttridge, who was the starter in that game, is projected to start today as well, but she missed 6 games this season. So a little bit of a different Otterbein team brought to the table for this matchup today as well. So that's just kind of an interesting point to point out. But Capital did lose pretty handily, 80-60. They did not show up for the game in the first half. They were down 39-24 at halftime in that game. In the first quarter alone, Capital was outscored by 7 and shot 4 of 12 from the field with 3 turnovers. And it wasn't much better in the second quarter either. They finally got some offense going towards the end of the game, but it didn't matter at that point with where the score was at. Just looking at just the roster and who played, you had 30 minutes from Bosch and 29 from Burns, which you would expect, but the 3 other starters, again, were not really a factor in that game. Ellie Watchman came off the bench and played just 7 minutes. I mentioned that Stonerock and Taphorn did not play in that game. Erica Linder ended up playing 34 minutes in that game. She was a starter at the time. She had been starting in that spot of Watchman, who's kind of taken over as Capital's gone to a bigger starting 5. But she played 34 minutes, which led the team. And Sam Seck, the senior, got a start in that game as well, played 15 minutes in that game for Seck. That was her lone start of the season. It was Linder, who had started 6 games this season. Brooke Amertz, who's been in the starting lineup a few times, mostly while Stonerock was out. She was in the starting lineup that day as well with 19 minutes played off the bench. The biggest contributor off the bench and the leading scorer in the game actually for Capital was Carly Hewlett, who is no longer on the roster. So it just is a completely different game, and to go back and break down the first matchup, I think, does not have a lot of relevance on the Capital side. On the Otterbein side, again, they don't have Kathleen DiCarlo, who had 9 points, 9 rebounds in that game. They do have everybody else. Delaney Cuttridge had a big game with 23 points. And Otterbein went to the free throw line 20 times, making 15 of them, and went 7 of 19 from three. Haley Bauer off the bench had 12 points, which I don't think we'll see again repeated today, but there's always been those outlier games. Marlo Taylor to be another example in the Marietta game where she got hot from three. So just preventing that perimeter defense, and that goes right with Coach White's key of ball pressure. You've got to make sure that you slow down this Otterbein attack and get out and defend, because they have a lot of players that can shoot from outside. And if you give them some room, they'll also have no problem penetrating and getting to the rack as well. So that's worth noting. Cutteridge shoots 42% from three. Abby Zirkle shoots 43% from three. Angelia Jackson, not great from three, but she shoots a lot of them, 29 for 99. Haley Bauer has had 33% off the bench as well. And then you've got the two down low that can really play as well with Abby Scholes. And now it's Brynn Mangold, who's averaging 3.5 points per game this season. But if you look at the conference schedule, it's gone up to about 4.5, and she's starting to have a bigger impact on this group due to the injuries of, again, at the time, Cutteridge and DeCarlo. And we'll have to see. Cutteridge is out there warming up. I believe she's going to play today, but we will look for that when the starting lineups are announced here in a few minutes. We'll take a timeout once again. When we come back, we will have the keys to today's game and some final thoughts here on the Freshies pregame show.
I wanted to fly. They said I couldn't. So I built a plane, then a spaceship, then I went to the moon. I invented jazz, hip-hop, rock and roll. Some called it noise. I said it was music. I wrote a letter and sent it by ponies. It didn't get to you fast enough, so I used trucks and ships. But still, they weren't fast enough for me. So I lost the paper and the ink. I sent it by magic. I called it email. I made up new words. Jukebox, bling, Google. And I decided some old words weren't okay to say ever again. The mustache. I tried to bring that back 17 times. I wore knickerbockers and shoulder pads, poodle skirts and flannel. When I came back from World War II, all I had was a t-shirt. So I made that cool. In fact, I invented cool. Who am I? I'm the spirit of youth. It's my job to move the world forward. Pepsi. Every generation refreshes the world.
Some final thoughts here from the Freshies pregame show. Again, I'm Jimmy Bloomfield. Thanks for tuning in. We've got a doubleheader for you tonight. Women will be up first. Men are going to get started around 7:30. And stay tuned after today's game. We'll bring you the ceremony here from the Capitol Center honoring the 95 women's championship game, or sorry, championship team in between games here. And kind of a different look for our postgame show tonight. So just wanted to make sure everyone's aware of that as we're about 5 minutes away from opening tip. In terms of keys to today's game, brought to you by the Marriott Columbus Airport location, we've kind of touched on the keys a little bit. I'm going to go a little bit off the grid from what I normally would, and it's weird to say it almost, but I think the Capitol outside shooting is going to be a big key in this game. I really like how they look from outside, and I think it's going to be very interesting to see what is going on with the outside game as Bosch is starting to get into it, which means that Burns is going to be a huge key. Cassidy Bosch is going to be a huge key. And I wouldn't be surprised to see some of these reserve players off the bench come in and knock in some outside shots. I just have a weird feeling about it. I don't know if you want to call it a key to the game, but I do think Capitol's outside shooting is going to play more of a role in this game than it typically would. Not a team that exactly loves to live and die on the three-point shot, but I have a feeling that is going to be a big key in this game in addition to the ones that Coach White gave us earlier. That'll do it for our pregame show. We're going to step aside for our national anthem and starting lineups. We'll be right after the break here on the Freshies pregame show.
Dill's Greenhouse is a local family business dedicated to offering the best shopping experience and honest prices for your gardening needs. If you're in need of annuals, perennials, vegetable plants, or any variety of gardening tools and resources, Dill's Greenhouse is more than happy to get you on the right path. Dill's Greenhouse is located at 5800 Rager Road in Groveport, Ohio, and is open 7 days a week. Visit them online for more information at dillsgreenhouse.net. Dill's Greenhouse. Only nature does it better.
With 14 TVs to watch your favorite team or the next big event, Blank's Cafe and Pizzeria in German Village is ready for you and your group today. Plenty of free parking, free Wi-Fi, banquet rooms for private parties and daily specials. What more reason do you need to visit Plank's Cafe and Pizzeria? Plank's is located at 743 Parsons Avenue and has been serving the Columbus community since 1939. Plank's is on the web at plankscafe.com or available by phone at 614-443-6251. Plank's Cafe and Pizzeria is a proud supporter of Crusader Athletics.
This is a message for all those MBA seekers out there. For the junior exec who'd rather be senior. For the VP yearning to be CEO. And for everyone who'd call their job not just a profession, but a passion. Capital University's MBA program was built exclusively for professionals, experienced faculty, flexible schedules, and classmates you'll soon consider colleagues. Learn more at capital.edu/MBA. The Capital University MBA, for those driven to do more.
Army ROTC is one of the best leadership courses in the country and can be a part of your college curriculum. As a potential or current student at Capital University, learning to become a leader will make your college experience even richer and prepare you for the future. Capital Army ROTC can provide scholarships and many more benefits to those who enroll, but the biggest benefit will be experienced firsthand after joining. For more information on Capital Army ROTC, testimonials, and an in-depth look at what the program can offer you, go to www.capital.edu/ROTC.
I wanted to fly. They said I couldn't. So I built a plane, then a...
New vehicles, reliable pre-owned vehicles, top-notch, high-quality service technicians, and friendly, trustworthy sales associates dedicated to customer service. Buyers Airport Subaru in Columbus is ready to get you into the vehicle that you were meant for. Stop by to see our selection at 401 North Hamilton Road in Columbus and take a test drive, or call Buyers Airport Subaru at 877-265-9695 today. Buyers Airport Subaru is a proud supporter of Crusader Athletics. Subaru, confidence in motion.
And welcome into the Capitol Center. We have starting lineups to bring you here for the matchup between the Otterbein Cardinals and the Capital University Crusaders. I'm Jim Bloomfield. Thanks, as always, for tuning in. And 2-5-6 teams, with the winner moving into sole possession of fourth place here in the OAC. So a lot to play for in this one. Capital trying to even out this season series with the Cardinals after losing 80-60 back on December 7th over in Westerville. Let's get to the starting lineups first for the Otterbein University Cardinals head coach Deanna Knowles in her first year, taking over for Connie Richardson and assisted by Mary Corbett and Connor Harris. The starters, it starts with number 4, senior 5'9 center out of Cincinnati, Abby Scholes. 5'6 junior guard out of Cincinnati, Angelia Jackson. A 5'8 sophomore guard out of Dayton, Ohio, Jenna Hoshower. 5'9 junior guard out of Springfield, Ohio, Abby Zirkel. And the 6'1 junior center out of Cincinnati, Bryn Mangold. So it's Scholes, Jackson, Hoshower, Zirkel, and Mangold. That means Delaney Cutteridge, who we mentioned is questionable for today, will not play in this matchup tonight for the Cardinals. On the other side for the Crusaders, head coach Dixie Jeffers in her 33rd year, assisted by Jason Wright, Molly Brennan, and Jill White. Capitals will send out senior forward out of Logan, Ohio, 5'9", Cassidy Bosch. 5'8", sophomore guard out of Westerville, Ohio, Emma Burns. A 5'9", junior guard out of Harrison, Ohio, Caroline Taphorn. Out of Upper Arlington, Ohio, the 6'10", senior forward, I'm sorry, 6'0" senior forward, Ellie Watchman. And lastly, another senior in the front court, 5'10" forward out of Westfall, Ohio, Reagan Stonerock. It's Bosch Burns, Taphorn, Watchman, and Stonerock for the Crusaders. Capital will be in their home gray uniforms, moving from right to left to start things off today. And the Cardinals in the red uniforms moving from left to right. And the Cardinals without two of their starters from the first matchup. That would be number 11, Delaney Cutteridge, and number 23, Kathleen DiCarlo. For Capital, they actually get two starters back in Reagan Stonerock and Caroline Taphorn, who did not play in the first game. And on top of that, Ellie Watchman played just 7 minutes off the bench in that first game. It's almost like they get a third extra starter. Will it make up a 20-point difference? Potentially, but we'll see. Opening tap goes to the Cardinals, and we're underway here from the Capitol Center. Game one of our doubleheader, a very good crowd on hand that is still having some students and others file in, as Otterbein has the first possession tonight. With 10 on the shot clock, not a whole lot developing. Jackson floats one in, and it's good. So not really a set offensive play or anything, but Jackson drives into the paint, throws it up and in, and Otterbein is first on the scoreboard today. 2-0 lead. Burns and Taphorn now working together. Goes to Stonerock at the top of the key. Reagan goes back to Burns on the outside. Inside pass, Watchman, great spot, and that's an easy basket for Watchman. That is automatic if they can get her on that side of the low block today with some frequency. Good find from Emma Burns. 2-2, 1 minute in. Pass to the right wing, a three ball thrown up, and that's no good. Capital gets the rebound, and they're out and running with it. Cassidy Bosch on the right wing. Drives in, gives it to Watchman. Watchman off the glass, no good. And the rebound is collected by Bryn Mangold. No relation to the Ohio State center, Nick Mangold, out of Cincinnati. A foul is called away from the basketball. I believe that's on Stonerock, unless, actually, they're calling a timeout for an injury situation. So no foul, and Otterbein has an injured player. Bryn Mangold, who we were just talking about, is bent over in some pain at the top of the court and did something to her ankle, it looks like, as the training staff for Otterbein is trying to help her off to the bench. I believe it's the right ankle that she's having an issue with. And immediately, some more injury situations for this Cardinals team that has been riddled by injuries already, down two starters. Peyton McCord out of Mount Vernon, 5'10 forward, will replace her, number five. And Otterbein will inbound with 18 seconds on the clock. Shot clock, that is. Pass goes into Hoschauer. And Hoschauer driving in on Taphorn, high off the glass, no good. And Stonerock gets the miss. Over to Burns. And Capital will set up their offensive chance for their first lead. Taphorn on the left wing. Gets a screen from Stonerock, fading away from the basket. That's a tough shot, and Caroline makes it look easy. 4-2, Capital out in front. Taphorn pressuring at full court here, trying to dribble Hoschauer into the corner, and she just does just that. Hoschauer turns it over and dribbles out of bounds as Taphorn single-handedly traps her. Burns off to Bosch now. Bosch is wide open. Take the shot, Cassidy. There it is. It's good. You can't give it to her. She's been on fire from outside. And another three-pointer good from Cassidy Bosch. She's now shooting over 42% from three this season. Just a week ago was under 38. She is really heating up from outside. They basically dared her to shoot. 7-2 lead for Capital. Hoschauer back to the top of the key. They swing it left side now. Jackson drives in, no good. Taphorn boxing out and keeps possession for Capital, getting physical there with Abby Scholes. Pass goes in to Emma Burns. Burns drives in. Kick to the corner for Bosch. Bosch thought about it again. I think she was just looking there to fake. Try to open up something for Ellie down low. Now it goes to Stonerock. Scholes jumps the pass, tips it, and Hoshauer comes away with it. Watchman fell in transition, but she comes back to poke the ball away. And now Emma Burns comes away with it for Capital. Over to Caroline Taphorn now. Taphorn has Burns on the outside. Three ball, no good. Burns was moving to her left as she shot that, and as a result, misses off. Now a three ball. Nope, good fake there from Jackson. Thought that one was going up. Jackson will instead wait for a better opportunity. Jackson gives off to Hoshauer, who calls out the play for the Otterbein offense. And a basket underneath for Abby Scholes. Really good find to set up Scholes underneath for an easy basket. And it's 7-4, 6:16 to play. We've had good tempo to this game. And Capitals look good offensively. There's another easy basket. Perfect execution again. 9-4. Ellie Watchman scores, and they call a foul against Caroline Taphorn here, who came back and took the ball away. But she's called for the foul instead. Haley Bauer will come in now. I mentioned she had 3 three-pointers in that first game, and Coach Jeffers having Taphorn's back a little bit here, talking to the official on the near sideline. Ball is inbounded now. Under 6 minutes to play in the first quarter. Bauer being defended by Bosch on the outside, gives off to McCord. Now on the right wing, it's Hoshauer. Calling for a screen, picks up her dribble, and then passes off to Abby Zirkel. Zirkel has nothing there on Burns. A contested shot in the paint at the end of the shot clock by Hoshauer, and Capital comes away with it. Now Burns on the weak side, has a look on the left-handed layup. It's good. Good find from Taphorn. It's 11-4 Capital. Timeout called by Otterbein, and Capital comes to the bench with some passion. They lead by 7, and we'll be right back. A 30-second timeout.
It's the perfect sports bar because it's not just a sports bar.
I'm Gary Calico, founder and president of Rusty Bucket. A lot of families build their sports world around the bucket.
It's not just a guy's night out. You can bring your wife, you can bring your kids.
We get a lot of groups in after games.
Great place after the game.
Kids love to come here.
The Rusty Bucket Restaurant and Tavern.
Grab life by the bucket.
The Rusty Bucket is a proud supporter of the Capital Crusaders. Visit us after the game at 2158 East Main Street and grab life by the...
The Crusaders lead 11-4, shooting 5 of 7 from the field right now. It's 71%. They are getting some really easy baskets. And on the other side, 2 for 6 so far for Otterbein with 2 turnovers. Watchman has 4 points to lead all scorers. 3 from Bosch, 2 from Burns, 2 from Taphorn, who also has 2 assists. Jackson and Scholes have the 2 baskets for Otterbein. This is Bauer with it. Gives off Zirkel. Now to Scholes. Bounce pass into McCord, and being harassed away from the basket by Watchman. They get it inside to Scholes. 2 to shoot, and somehow Otterbein gets a quality look out of that possession. It didn't look like they were going to get one. Scholes gets her second basket. 11-6 our score. Pass from Taphorn. Actually, that's Linder in there, excuse me, giving off to Watchman, and it's going to result in a jump ball as Linder gets down there. Linder replacing Taphorn, likely due to Caroline picking up the foul. That sent us to that timeout. Brooke Ummerts and Kaylee Cyphers will check in for the 2 post players, Watchman and Stonerock. Cypher's really starting to become a weapon for this Capital team. Just a nice 6-footer to throw in, and she's going to have a big role as a sophomore on this Capital team with all the senior leadership in the front court leaving. Linder giving off to Ummert, who will also likely be a starter next year for Capital. Giving off to Bosch now, who absorbs contact, throws it up, no good. But she'll get 2 free throws. Capital in good control of this game early on, and if they can keep this up, obviously put themselves in a good position to win this ball game. Coming out now is Abby Scholes. She's replaced by Danielle Horsley, out of Bucyrus, 5'9" forward. First free throw from Cassidy is good. Bosch now with 4 points. Capitals, three starters in the front court. Bosch, Stonerock, and Watchman, all freshmen. You obviously have some leadership in the backcourt with Burns being a junior next year and Taphorn as a senior. But then you've got some question marks down. I wouldn't say question marks, but younger players for sure in your front court with Cyphers in the mix. Jossie Kaiser will be a senior. Ledbetter, a sophomore, foul called here. And Amert would be a junior, I guess, as well. Definitely will be a younger Capital team once again next year. Cord goes to the line. Her first free throw is good. Peyton, a sophomore, 5'10", out of Mount Vernon, Ohio, who replaced the injured Bryn Mangold, who is in there for the injured Kathleen DiCarlo. A lane violation is called against Otterbein on the second free throw, so it's no good. Taking a look at the Otterbein bench, it doesn't look like Mangold is in good shape right now to come back in. She's still sitting at the end of the Otterbein bench, not with the rest of the team, and looks to be in a great bit of discomfort. Capital goes to work offensively after the lane violation. It's Amert on the right elbow, giving off to Burns. Not the cleanest of passes, but goes inside on the low block. This is Cyphers, who has size advantage, but goes a little bit too strong off the rim. Bauer with it for the Cardinals on the other side. Bauer, great job by Burns to get through that screen, and now they pass off to the left, and Horsley dribbles after taking a step, which is a travel. Amert gets it into Burns to start things again. That's the third turnover for the Cardinals. Taphorn getting ready to come back on for Capital. Bosch at the top of the key. Long two, no good. Amert gets a hand in there, but the rebound is collected by Otterbein. Logan Fox for Otterbein just checked in. She brings it across the timeline, and the Cardinals go into their sets. This is one of the stronger defensive efforts we've seen from Capital this year. Burns comes off for Taphorn. ...13-7. Still our score. Pass goes into Hoshauer at the top of the key. Guarded by Taphorn. A foul is called away from the ball. It's going to go on Bosch, actually. That's Cassidy's first. The third on the team. Cyphers, Taphorn, and Bosch each with one foul. Three ball off the inbound. No good. And Cyphers comes to crash the boards. Gets it to Linder. Linder runs across the timeline. Nowhere to go here. And smartly will pull back and wait for reinforcements behind her. Pass goes off to Bosch now. Bosch gets it to Amert at the top of the key. Looking left. Looking back right. Has Linder again. Linder back to Amert. And they're just working this outside right now. Bosch sets up. Three ball. Yes, ma'am. Cassidy Bosch with another triple. She has 8, and Capital leads by 9. Bosch has now made her last 5 threes taking over this homestand, going back to Wednesday night. 16-7 our score. Scholes, no good. On the shot, rebound is collected by Horsley. Horsley with a fresh shot clock, shoots for 3, no good. And Cassidy Bosch wins the rebound battle. 16-7, Taphorn drives inside, Euro step, foul from behind, almost got the layup there, but the killer instinct there from Taphorn to get to the rack, and she'll go to the free throw line. That's the second foul on Abby Scholes as well, which will be a big problem for Otterbein, who's already short in depth. And McCord will come in for Scholes due to that second foul. Mangold and Scholes, their two front court players in the starting lineup, likely won't see the floor in the second quarter. Taphorn makes the free throw here. Taphorn did not play in the first game against Otterbein due to a coach's decision. She has started every other game that she's played here in 2020. Cassidy Bosch with the steal. 10-point first quarter for Bosch. It's 20-7, Capital all over Otterbein right now. And Bosch is outscoring them by herself, 10-7. Hoshauer gets across to the left wing now. Abby Zirkel drives in, and a good answer to stop the Capital run. But Capital still ahead by double figures and looking for more. Taphorn gets a screen from Cyphers. Ball kicked away from her. Now gets it to Amert. Amert to Linder on the baseline for Bosch. And he actually shoots it over the basket. Thought it was going straight in. But it went exactly over the hoop and an air ball. Collected the other way. Cassie's been on fire. Just assumed it was going to go in. Bauer trying to drive on Bosch, who blocks the shot. Taphorn collects the miss. 3-on-2 the other way. Come the Crusaders. Linder drives to the basket. A tough lay-in. Good. And she's fouled. 22-9. That was an impressive layup from Linder, who put a lot of English on that thing. And it spun off the backboard and in. Capital has all the momentum right now. Allison Roach comes on with Stone Rock, Burns, and Watchman as well. Linder with a free throw to make it 23. It's good. 23-9. Capital leads by 14. And here comes a new group that is already flying for Capital. Roach hounding Hoshauer defensively. And Hoshauer able to get the shot up and in still. Roach now on the right wing. Gets the screen from Watchman. Now drives in herself. It was blocked from behind by McCord. Jackson gets the miss. Jackson pushes it up to Hoshauer. Hoshauer attacking the basket. Outside three ball. That's good from outside. Abby Zirkel. And a little 5-0 spurt here from Otterbein has them back to within 9. Capital will slow for the last shot of the quarter. They lead 23-14. Burns pulls back. And will dribble out the clock here. 17 now to shoot. She drives in and she's blocked. Not what Capital was looking for there. A block from Hoshauer. And now a tip pass inside. Still makes it to Horsley, who gets the basket to go. 4 seconds left. Linder throws it up. She still had some time. It does go out of bounds as the clock expires. But Linder had a few more seconds there to get to half court. A strong finish there at the end of the quarter from Otterbein. They put together a 7-0 run, and it's 23-16 now as we head into quarter number 2 here from the Capital Center.
This is a message for all those MBA seekers out there. For the junior exec who'd rather be senior, for the VP yearning to be CEO, and for everyone who'd call their job not just a profession, but a passion. Capital University's MBA program was built exclusively for professionals, experienced faculty, flexible schedules, and classmates you'll soon consider colleagues. Learn more at capital.edu/MBA. The Capital University MBA, for those driven to do more.
Army ROTC is one of the best leadership courses in the country and can be a part of your college curriculum. As a potential or current student at Capital University, learning to become a leader will make your college experience even richer and prepare you for the future. Capital Army ROTC can provide scholarships and many more benefits to those who enroll, but the biggest benefit will be experienced firsthand after joining. For more information on Capital Army ROTC, testimonials, and an in-depth look at what the program can offer you, go to www.capital.edu/ROTC.
Starters back on for Capital. Meanwhile, for Otterbein, a little bit of a different look with Bauer staying out there. Jackson, as well as Horsley, McCord, and Zirkel. They have two injured players in their starting five today. One injured player and one that's in foul trouble with two fouls, and that's Abby Schultz and Bryn Mangold. Burns, after a takeaway, gets it back down to Stone Rock, and they'll slow things down now for Capital's offense. Bosch and Taphorn each playing with one foul. Need to be careful about that. Taphorn inside, Stone Rock, good patience, and it's good. Bauer comes over the top of her, and she just sits there and waits, and Stone Rock then throws it in. Charge called. Taphorn draws another foul and causes a turnover defensively, as an armbar kind of push-off was called against Otterbein. Capital shooting 52% still on the game, 2 of 3 from outside. Otterbein shooting 46%. Bosch leading all scorers. Burns from three, no good. Rebound collected by Jackson. 10 from Bosch, 4 from Taphorn, 4 from Watchman. And now 2 from Reagan Stonerock. 2 for Burns and 3 for Linder for Capital in the first. Abby Zirkle with 5 and Abby Scholes with 2 fouls has 4 for Otterbein. Shot here, no good, off the hands of Abby Zirkle. Capital will head up the other side of the court now. Burns and Bosch working together on the outside. Screen from Watchman coming. Bosch, 3 ball again. It's good. She's starting to get the shooter's roll as well. That's now 6 for 6 over the last 2 games from 3 for Bosch. Taphorn hounding Bauer again. That's a moving screen, to say the least. No foul, no whistle, and 15 seconds on the shot clock now for Otterbein. Bosch is guarding Jackson. Pass is knocked away, but still gets to Zirkle. Zirkle from the free throw line, no good, and Cassidy Bosch gets the miss. Bosch with 13 points already. Cassidy's career high is 20, set earlier this season. Goes to Stone Rock now, who drives in. And blocked by McCord. Otterbein gets it across the timeline here. More students continuing to fill in the student section here at the Capitol Center. Off of Stone Rock's foot, so that'll stay here. All right, 3 subs coming on for Otterbein. Abby Scholes is going to play with her with her 2 fouls. That's interesting. Checking in as well is Miranda Martindale. She's a senior, a guard at 5'3", number 2. And the last substitution was Hoshauer, who we saw earlier in this contest. Actually, Katie Blair checking in as well out of Delaware. 3 to shoot, and Bauer will shoot and miss everything. Tapped out of bounds by Otterbein, but it's a shot clock violation anyway. Amert replaces Watchman. 28-16, Capital still in front. I've mentioned this a few times, but the winner of this game moves into sole possession of 4th place in the OAC with a 6-6 record. The other falls into a 3-way tie for 5th. Lots to play for in this one for both sides, in addition to the rivalry itself. Taphorn. It's a screen from Amert, drips it into Amert, and now Amert gets the layup to go. 30-16, assist for Taphorn again. On the outside is Hoshauer, lost it for a second. Taphorn gets a hand in the face on the shot, and Stone Rock gets the miss. Otterbein having a lot of one-and-done possessions. They also are losing the turnover battle right now by 6, 7-1 in that category. Stone Rock gets it from Taphorn. Burns on the outside. Emma drives in, floater, no good. Ball is still loose, and Cassidy Bosch comes up with it. Double team and a tie-up, I guess. I don't think that was a tie-up. That was a quick whistle. And then Taphorn got hit in the head with the ball that Bosch was trying to throw towards Taphorn, but she didn't realize it was coming. And she got hit in the head with the side of the ball. And she's okay. Coach Jeffers just pulling her out for a second just to let her collect herself. Taphorn to the sideline, and Linder replaces her. Linder has it for Capital as we close in on the 6-minute mark here in the second quarter. Linder gets it off. Burns, 3 ball, has space. It's good. Well, I don't want to call myself a genius or anything, but I did say the key to the game would be Capital's outside shooting, And that's normally not an area of strength for Capital, but today it has been. 4 for 6 now from outside, and an offensive foul, meanwhile, called against Abby Schultz. That's her third now. So Schultz is trying to get an explanation from the official here and is refusing to come off the floor. And now a technical could be called at this point. Schultz laughs it off as she heads to the bench with 3. So the decision to put her in with 2 comes back and hurts Deanna Knowles. Sam Seck, meanwhile, checks in for Capital. She brings it across the floor. Actually, that's Burns, excuse me, bringing it across. Amert now gives it off to Burns. Burns looks down low for Seck, and they'll reset. Now gets a screen from Stone Rock. Come on. I think that's a little bit of a makeup call, or whatever you want to call it. I don't like that for Stone Rock getting that offensive foul there, but it is what it is. Stone Rock comes off and Watchman comes back on. 33-16, Capital still out in front. Winning this game by 17, but it still feels like Otterbein is in shouting distance, and we've seen big comebacks both on Capital's side and against us throughout the season. And Otterbein is shooting 40% from the field. Capital shooting 52. Those numbers are both going to come more to life and go back to the norms. Capital's destroying the rebounding battle right now on the offensive side as well. Only one offensive rebound for the Cardinals. That's the second. Make that the third one that Capital just got right there. Linder for 3. No, misses everything. Amert with a fantastic save, but it goes right to Otterbein. And then a tie-up caused by Watchman. So Amert makes that save, and Watchman makes sure it's not for nothing at least, and they'll switch the possession arrow as Otterbein will keep possession. The Cardinals have 7 seconds to get across the timeline now. They will with ease. Linder, Amert, Watchman, Burns, and Seck, the 5 out there for Capital right now. Jackson left open, 3 ball, no good. That should be over the back, and it's going to stay here. That's ridiculous, as Burns was in great position, boxing out, and it's tapped out of bounds off of Burns. I don't think the argument here for Coach Jeffers is that it's out on Capital. It's more so that that shouldn't have been even a question. It should have been over the back and whistled dead right then and there. But Otterbein stays with it. Hoshauer has to kick out to avoid a travel and gives off to Zirkle now. Zirkle inside. A foul is called on, I believe, Watchman. Now they're going to give it on Seck. 21, not 24. Still no Capital players with 2 fouls, and there's only 1 with 2 fouls for Otterbein, and it's Abby Schultz with 3. Zirkle gets the layup to go. Abby Zirkle, a junior out of Springfield, Ohio. 3rd leading scorer on the team with 9.7 points per game. 78% at the free throw line. She splits a pair here. Watchman rises up and gets the rebound. Capital leads by 14. Otterbein still kind of hanging around. Amert gets some space off the glass. No good. Seck is on the end line as she gets that rebound. Cassidy Bosch back in for Burns. Taphorn checks in for Seck. Taphorn defending full court here. Hoshauer getting a couple of screens from McCord and now gets it back to set up the offense for the Cardinals. Hoshauer kicking out. Inside pass to McCord now at the free throw line. Watchman reads it, blocks it, and gives it off to Taphorn. Another empty possession for the Cardinals. Taphorn fakes the pass, goes straight to the hoop on Hoshauer, lost her footing, and goes out of bounds. Bauer checks back on now, replacing Hoshauer. Bauer is the best ball handler on the court right now for the Cardinals, which could be an issue. Bauer being guarded by Taphorn again. Defensively dribbling and gives it off now to Zirkel. Zirkel being guarded by Linder. Pass off to the top of the key. Horsley playing a lot of minutes in this game due to the situation in the post for Otterbein. Jackson throws up another miss. Linder gets the rebound. Timeout called by Capital. 33-19, still our score. And a quick 30-second timeout for Capital to refocus here down the stretch.
Lunch, the most unappreciated meal of the day, which is why we at Freshy are screaming from the rooftops, let there be lunch. And no, not a sad sandwich at your desk. We're talking a flavorful Tex-Mex burrito after a brisk walk, or a nutritious Kale Caesar with your work bestie. So let's do our minds, bodies, and taste buds a favor, and let there be lunch. Download the game-changing new Freshy app to have your food ready, or order at Freshy.com.
Welcome back to the Capitol Center. Game one of a doubleheader. Charlie Danis will be joining you for game two tonight with the men taking on Otterbein as well. Should be a really fun atmosphere throughout the night. A reminder to stay tuned in between the games. We will have a ceremony here at the Capitol Center to honor the 1994-1995 championship team. For Capital. Linder for three. It's good. That's five triples now for Capital in the first half. 36-19. Linder now has 6 points after the impressive layup back in the first quarter. Three ball here from Bauer. No good on the bank. Offensive rebound Horsley and left it short off the net and then grabs her miss and puts it in. Still a 15-point game. Stonerock from Taphorn. Back to Caroline. Back to Linder. Bounce pass over to Bosch. Bosch still leading all scorers with 13. No one else on either team has more than 6. Cassidy to the free throw line. Block again by Peyton McCourt. Jackson comes away with it. Pulls up and her shot left short. Bauer gets the miss. Over to Jackson. They'll reset. Zirkel has it now. Horsley at the top of the key. And Bauer will reset. 135 left to play in the first half. Into McCord, goes right to Taphorn, the easiest steal she'll ever have, as it just rolls to her feet and she bends over and picks it up. 36-21. Taphorn has options here, now calls everybody off, gets the screen from Stonerock, looked that way. And they'll swing it back around. Bosch drives baseline, layup, way too high off the backboard. McCord gets the miss. 1 minute to play in the first half. Bauer, again, not a great ball handler. I don't know what the options are for Otterbein, but they really don't have a true ball handler on the floor right now. Jackson having trouble with the dribble, right on cue. Jackson losing a lot of time in this possession. Now it is 7 to work with, and a travel is called before the bounce pass to Bauer. Well, when you don't have a true ball handler, it's hard to distribute the basketball and set up your teammates, and that shows the importance right there. 42 seconds left. Erica Linder will bring it across the timeline for Capital. They had the option of a 2-for-1, but they slow it down instead. Not a bad call when you're up by 15. Taphorn gets the wide open lane, and it's good. Caroline, 6 points, 3 assists, a block, a rebound, and a steal. Pretty good first half. Otterbein answering quickly. For some reason, Zirkel goes right to the hole there and puts a second foul on Cassidy Bosch right at the end of the quarter. Bosch comes off for Burns. Thirty-eight, 21. Zirkle gets the layup to go. Second free throw from Zirkle, who leads Otterbein with 7 points. Last chance for Capital here at the end of the half, and Taphorn puts a layup in on a floater. 4 seconds left, 3 for Jackson. She's gonna have to shoot. She gets it off in time, and it's no good. 40-23, what a statement made in the first half here by the Crusaders, as they lead by 17 over the Cardinals. Let's move into our ROTC halftime show, brought to you by the Capital University ROTC. What if you could take a college course that not only required textbooks, but courage, determination, and a good pair of boots, a course that would lead directly to a career as a leader, not an intern or assistant, ready to become a student and a leader? Enroll in Capital University Army ROTC, in which you could get a full tuition scholarship and graduate a leader and officer in the U.S. Army. To learn more about Army ROTC, call 614-236-6808 for more information. That number once again is 614-236-6808, or go to capital.edu/ROTC to learn more information about the Capital University Army ROTC. We'll be right back from the Capital Center.
Army ROTC is one of the best leadership courses in the country and can be a part of your college curriculum. As a potential or current student at Capital University, learning to become a leader will make your college experience even richer and prepare you for the future. Capital Army ROTC can provide scholarships and many more benefits to those who enroll, but the biggest benefit will be experienced firsthand after joining. For more information on Capital Army ROTC, testimonials, and an in-depth look at what the program can offer you, go to www.capital.edu/ROTC.
New vehicles, reliable pre-owned vehicles, top-notch, high-quality service technicians, and friendly, trustworthy sales associates dedicated to customer service. Buyers Airport Subaru in Columbus is ready to get you into the vehicle that you were meant for. Stop by to see our selection at 401 North Hamilton Road in Columbus and take a test drive, or call Buyers Airport Subaru at 877-265-9695 today. Buyers Airport Subaru is a proud supporter of Crusader Athletics. Subaru, confidence in motion.
It's the perfect sports bar because it's not just a sports bar.
I'm Gary Calico, founder and president of Rusty Bucket. A lot of families build their sports world around the bucket.
It's not just a guy's night out. You can bring your wife, you can bring your kids.
We get a lot of groups in after games.
Great place after the game.
Kids love to come here.
The Rusty Bucket Restaurant and Tavern.
The Rusty Bucket is a proud supporter of the Capital Crusaders. Visit us after the game at 2158 East Main Street and grab life by the bucket.
Lunch, the most unappreciated meal of the day, which is why we at Freshy are screaming from the rooftops, let there be lunch. And no, not a sad sandwich at your desk. We're talking a flavorful Tex-Mex burrito after a brisk walk, or a nutritious Kale Caesar with your work bestie. So let's do our minds, bodies, and taste buds a favor, and let there be lunch. Download the game-changing new Freshy app to have your food ready, or order at Freshy.com.
And welcome back to the Capital Center and the Army ROTC Halftime Show. Let's check in on our OAC standings. Again, this is brought to you by Army ROTC. We would normally have scores for you of games in action, but we're fortunate enough today to have all the games done before us. So these are all finals. John Carroll defeating Marietta 74-50, and Baldwin Wallace defeating Muskingum 86-56. But that's just where the fun starts. Ohio Northern defeats Mount Union 70-63, a huge win for Capital because Mount Union will stay behind us in the standings, win or lose. And the biggest of all, the upset for Heidelberg, defeating Wilmington 71-68. Heidelberg now one game out of the playoffs in that postseason tournament. And more importantly for Capital, a loss to Wilmington puts Capital in front of Wilmington for the time being, depending on the result of this game, which has been a good one so far for Capital. So the updated standings now: Baldwin Wallace and John Carroll each 11-1, Ohio Northern is 9-3. The winner of the game here today will be 6-6. The loser will fall to 5-7, and in a tie for fifth with Marietta and Wilmington, both at 5-7. Holding down the eighth spot is Mount Union, currently at 4-8. Heidelberg right there in the picture now at 3-9, and Muskingum is right behind them at 1-11. Well, let's talk about the first half now, and our halftime stats are brought to you by Planks Cafe. Capital had no problems with Otterbein in that first half of play, leading the first quarter 23-16, and that was with a 7-0 run in the last minute and a half. And they're also all over Otterbein in that second quarter 17-7. Capital has 11 points off Otterbein's turnovers. Otterbein has just two. They're winning the turnover battle right now 10-3, so a plus 7 for Capital. Overall, Capital is shooting 48% on the game, 5 of 8 from 3, 62%, and 5 of 5 from the line. For Otterbein, 9 of 27 and 1 of 8 from 3, that's 33% and 12.5. Capital is led by as much as 17, and they spent 18 minutes and 11 seconds with the lead in that first half of play. Individually, Cassidy Bosch with 13 points, 2 steals, a block, and 4 rebounds, leading the way for Capital, a plus-minus of 26. Caroline Taphorn with 8 points, also a plus-minus that's high at 24. She has a steal and 3 assists and a rebound. Erica Linder off the bench has 6 points, third on Capital. Emma Burns with 5, Watchman 4, and Reagan Stonerock and Brooke Ammer each have 2 to total 40. On the other side, for Otterbein, arguably their best player, Abby Schultz, has played just 8 minutes. She has 4 points, but she has 3 fouls and a minus 13 plus minus. That is a huge issue with her in that foul situation. Bryn Mangold, the other starter in the front court, played just 1 minute and 28 seconds before leaving the game due to injury. Angelia Jackson has just 2 points, and Jenna Hoshauer also has just 2 points. Abby Zirkel has been good. The starter has a 3-pointer and 8 points on the game. And off the bench, Danielle Horsley has 6 points and 5 rebounds in 10 minutes after being kind of just thrown into action. But other than those two, it's been really no bright spots for this Otterbein team. On the other side for Capital, it's been the Cassidy Bosch Show. She's our halftime hero of the first half, brought to you by Freshies. Healthy, fast, casual food that's good for the body and soul. And congratulations to Cassidy Bosch, again, our halftime hero. And she is just really blossoming here. This homestand now from outside has made all 3-pointers that she's attempted 6 for 6. And Capital's outside game, a big reason right now while they're up by 17. That will do it. We'll have one more break and then come back with keys to the second half and more second half action from the Capital Center.
It's the perfect sports bar because it's not just a sports bar.
I'm Gary Calico, founder and president of Rusty Bucket. A lot of families build their sports world around the bucket.
It's not just a guy's night out. You can bring your wife. You can bring your kids.
We get a lot of groups in after games.
Great place after the game.
Kids love to come here.
The Rusty Bucket Restaurant and Tavern.
Life by the Bucket.
The Rusty Bucket is a proud supporter of the Capital Crusaders. Visit us after the game at 2158 East Main Street and grab life by the bucket.
With 14 TVs to watch your favorite team or the next big event, Planks Cafe and Pizzeria in German Village is ready for you and your group today. Plenty of free parking, free Wi-Fi, banquet rooms for private parties and daily specials. What more reason do you need to visit Planks Cafe and Pizzeria? Planks is located at 743 Parsons Avenue and has been serving the Columbus community since 1939. Planks is on the web at plankscafe.com or available by phone at 614-443-6251. Planks Cafe and Pizzeria is a proud supporter of Crusader Athletics.
This is a message for all those MBA seekers out there. For the junior exec who'd rather be senior. For the VP yearning to be CEO. And for everyone who'd call their job not just a profession, but a passion. Capital University's MBA program was built exclusively for professionals, experienced faculty, flexible schedules, and classmates you'll soon consider colleagues. Learn more at capital.edu/MBA. The Capital University MBA, for those driven to do more.
Army ROTC is one of the best leadership courses in the country and can be a part of your college curriculum. As a potential or current student at Capital University, learning to become a leader will make your college experience even richer and prepare you for the future. Capital Army ROTC can provide scholarships and many more benefits to those who enroll, but the biggest benefit will be experienced firsthand after joining. For more information on Capital Army ROTC, testimonials, and an in-depth look at what the program can offer you, go to www.capital.edu/ROTC.
New vehicles, reliable pre-owned vehicles, top-notch, high-quality service technicians, and friendly, trustworthy sales associates dedicated to customer service. Buyers Airport Subaru in Columbus is ready to get you into the vehicle that you were meant for. Stop by to see our selection at 401 North Hamilton Road in Columbus and take a test drive, or call Buyers Airport Subaru at 877-265-9695 today. Buyers Airport Subaru is a proud supporter of Crusader Athletics. Subaru, confidence in motion.
OSU Sports Medicine is a proud supporter of Crusader student-athletes by providing sports health services for Capital University athletics and student health services. Through the work and care of team physicians and athletic trainers, it's the team behind your team. For all fans, if you're looking to improve your physical performance, recover from an injury, or stay active for a lifetime, the experts at Ohio State Sports Medicine are there for you. Visit sportsmedicine.osu.edu or call 366-4332.
Welcome back to the Capitol Center. 40-23 our score. Last segment here of the our Capitol University ROTC halftime show. And it's time to revisit the keys from the first half. And again, I don't want to toot my own horn or anything, but I did say some outside shooting would be a difference for Capitol in this one, and call it a hunch, but it's been money. Capitol, 5 of 8 from three. Three different players have made one, and Cassidy Bosch is 3 for 3. At this point, now it goes back to Coach White's pregame interview, in which he said ball pressure and taking care of the basketball, Capitol +7 and turnovers in that first half, more of the same, will lead to a Capitol victory in half number two. Your keys to the second half brought to you by the Marriott Columbus Airport, and we'll take our final break before more basketball here at the Capitol Center.
With 14 TVs to watch your favorite team or the next big event, Blank's Cafe and Pizzeria in German Village is ready for you and your group today. Plenty of free parking, free Wi-Fi, banquet rooms for private parties and daily specials. What more reason do you need to visit Plank's Cafe and Pizzeria? Plank's is located at 743 Parsons Avenue and has been serving the Columbus community since 1939. Plank's is on the web at plankscafe.com or available by phone at 614-443-6251. Plank's Cafe and Pizzeria is a proud supporter of Crusader Athletics.
This is a message for all those MBA seekers out there. For the junior exec who'd rather be senior. For the VP yearning to be CEO. And for everyone who'd call their job not just a profession, but a passion. Capital University's MBA program was built exclusively for professionals, experienced faculty, flexible schedules, and classmates you'll soon consider colleagues. Learn more at capital.edu/MBA. The Capital University MBA, for those driven to do more.
Army ROTC is one of the best leadership courses in the country and can be a part of your college curriculum. As a potential or current student at Capital University, learning to become a leader will make your college experience even richer and prepare you for the future. Capital Army ROTC can provide scholarships and many more benefits to those who enroll, but the biggest benefit will be experienced firsthand after joining. For more information on Capital Army ROTC, testimonials, and an in-depth look at what the program can offer you, go to www.capital.edu/ROTC.
I wanted to fly. They said I couldn't. So I built a plane, then a spaceship, then I went to the moon. I invented jazz, hip-hop, rock and roll. Some called it noise. I said it was music. I wrote a letter and sent it by ponies. Didn't get to you fast enough, so I used trucks and ships. But still, they weren't fast enough for me. So I lost the paper and the ink. I sent it by magic. I called it email. I made up new words. Jukebox, bling, Google. And I decided some old words weren't okay to say ever again. The mustache. I tried to bring that back 17 times. I wore knickerbockers and shoulder pads, poodle skirts and flannel. When I came back from World War II, all I had was a t-shirt. So I made that cool. In fact, I invented cool. Who am I? I'm the spirit of youth. It's my job to move the world forward. Pepsi. Every generation refreshes the world.
Well, game one has gone as planned so far for the Crusaders. They lead this one by a current score of 40-23. Game two is coming up next. That is men's basketball here, Capitol versus Otterbein. It is a pretty full crowd now here at the Capitol Center, as the student section, as you can see to the right, is pretty much getting to that point where it's going to be filled. More and more have filled in throughout the halftime show. You can see the men's basketball team itself is in the last section there to the right. Capitol will send their starting five out there of Burns, Taphorn, Bosch, Stonerock, and Watchman. We're waiting on Otterbein. Bryn Mangold is still sitting at the end of the bench with a head in her hands and has a trainer there as well working on something. So she will not start the second half. Abby Schultz has three fouls. She will not start the second half. So it's Jackson out there with Hoshauer, Zirkel, McCord, and Horsley. And actually, now that is the starting five out there for Otterbein. Burns thought about a three. Now backs into one. No good. Stonerock, offensive rebound. And throws it right to McCord. Otterbein is down by 17, but it still kind of feels like they're in this game. Hoshauer getting hounded by Taphorn, and is that going to be a foul? Yeah, it's going to be on Taphorn. That's Taphorn's second. It gets some boos here in the stadium. I don't hate the call there. I think Taphorn was being a little bit aggressive. Hoshauer was happy with the call, but she's going to have a lot of pressure on her from Taphorn trying to take it away from her, and there's no other true ball handler really with Cutridge being hurt. Horsley has been such a great addition to this lineup in rotation off the bench. She has eight for the Cardinals. Taphorn on left wing, skip pass to Bosch. Bosch looks inside now. Watchman back out to Stonerock. No good. Bosch the putback. Yes! Cassidy Bosch, our halftime hero, with 15. And Otterbein still trails by 17. Capitol with a win would become the fourth place team in the OAC as Horsley shoots a three. No good. Rebound Watchman. Capitol would also move just two games back of that number three spot with Ohio Northern. They could theoretically still catch them, make that three games back, but they're going to need a lot of help. Stonerock, bounce pass to Taphorn, inside Watchman. Quick move, she's fouled, basket's good. Crusaders continuing a dominant first half with a great start to the second. Capitol won 91-64 in the first game of this little trip here at home, where they've had they will have 5 of 6 at home. This is game two of that stretch. And to this point, they're outscoring a Muskingum and Otterbein teams combined in six quarters and change by 40 points. 47 to be exact. Bosch gets the steal. Cassidy throws it out ahead to herself, and she's blocked by Hoshauer. Great timing there by Hoshauer to block them away. Capitol's men's team making their way over to the locker room now behind us. Taphorn in to Watchman. Skip hop through the lane. No good. She taps it out, and the rebound's collected by Horsley. Horsley gets it off to Jackson, now being guarded by Taphorn. Jackson passing off to Zirkel, who led the Cardinals in first half points. Zirkel blocked by Watchman. The defense has been just as good as the offense. 2-on-1 the other way. Watchman loses the basketball, and that was ugly, but it turns into free throws. Capital student section has the men's team that vacated, so now they'll fill in and be an impact here in the second half. You can see them moving around back there. Stone Rock gets two free throws. That's good on the first. 3 points now for Stone Rock with five rebounds. Second free throw, no good, but Capital gets the offensive rebound. Watchman, Burns, three ball. How about that? A four-point sequence there for Capital instead. Their sixth three. And they lead by 24, 49-25. Capital had a statement to make after losing by 20 in the first matchup. They got healthy, and they are pummeling Otterbein today. Jackson loses it. Another turnover. Timeout called by Otterbein. It'll be a full timeout as they talk over what is going on right now. A 9-2 run to start the second half in 3 minutes, and Capital leads by 24.
OSU Sports Medicine is a proud supporter of Crusader student athletes by providing sports health services for Capital University athletics and student health services. Through the work and care of team physicians and athletic trainers, it's the team behind your team. For all fans, if you're looking to improve your physical performance, recover from an injury, or stay active for a lifetime, the experts at Ohio State Sports Medicine are there for you. Visit sportsmedicine.osu.edu or call 366-4332. Army ROTC is one of the best leadership courses in the country and can be a part of your college curriculum. As a potential or current student at Capital University, learning to become a leader will make your college experience even richer and prepare you for the future. Capital Army ROTC can provide scholarships and many more benefits to those who enroll, but the biggest benefit will be experienced firsthand after joining. For more information on Capital Army ROTC, testimonials, and an in-depth look at what the program can offer you, go to www.capital.edu/ROTC.
Welcome back to the Capital Center. Crusaders by 24, leading 49-25. Game two, the men's game will be coming up after this one. Emma Burns brings it across for Capital. Passes to Bosch as they break through a zone pressure here from Otterbein. It looks like they've switched to a 2-3 zone. Bosch will shoot right through that. No problem. 7-for-7 on the homestand for Bosch. She has 18, too high of a career high, and Capital leads now 52-25. Foul called against Tapper. So she'll have to come out now with three fouls. Linder will replace her. Capital by 27. Zirkel goes to the line. First one is good. That's actually Jenna Hoshauer at the line, so she is up to 3 points now. Hoshauer out of Dayton. She makes both. Otterbein's got a long way to go here. And a jump ball will help. That's a turnover for Capital. It's just their fifth. Logan Fox checks back in for Otterbein, replacing Hoshauer. And once again, their best ball handler is Bauer. Fortunately for them, however, Taphorn is on the bench, so Burns will be the one guarding. Jackson trying to get something going on Bosch. Who are they calling that one on? That's on Watchman, I guess. Abby Schultz has checked in for Otterbein with three fouls, and she might not have a game to come back into if you continue to wait longer, so they have to bring her in now. Watchman picks up her second. Pass is thrown into the backcourt, and that's another turnover. 13 now for Otterbein. Capital plus 9 in turnovers, plus 3 in rebounds. Plus 4 points in the paint, plus 7 in second chance points, plus 10 in fast break points. Points off turnovers, Capital plus 10. And what's the discussion about here? Are they going to say this was tipped? Coach Jeffers is stealing a quick timeout out of this. Don't know what this could possibly be about. It did not look like it was tipped. The shot clock is showing 11 seconds. I mean, that would clearly need to be reset as well. And one of our officials is over here at the scorer's table. Pop in the game mic, but I cannot hear this conversation, unfortunately. So we'll have to wait for an explanation. Capital once again will come over and talk to Coach Jeffers. The official is coming over and discussing something with head coach Deanna Knowles, and now coming to Coach Jeffers as well. And he was pointing towards the student section. They put 2 additional seconds on the clock, which I don't think matters, and they've reset the shot clock to 30. And it's Capital basketball. So they stopped the game and put 2 seconds on the clock. I think that's going to make a huge impact on this one as the pass goes into Emma Burns. On the right wing, it's Bosch. Bosch back to Burns. Burns for 3, no good. And Stone Rock rises up for the rebound. Gives off to Bosch. Bosch wanted to get a shot off, but instead will reset. Drops it into Watchman. Back to Bosch. Bosch extra pass to Linder. 10 to shoot for Capital. Bosch being hounded defensively by Fox. Gives into the corner. Burns, 3 ball. No good. And now Watchman is called for a foul. And now earlier there was an over and back, over the back called. That was miss. And in this case, they call one on Watchman. And looked like that wasn't really necessary to be called. Watchman picks up the foul nonetheless. It is her second. I said earlier that was her second. It's actually her second now. She did not have a foul in the first half, so that's the good news. And Capital still ahead 52-27. That was a long sequence, too, with all the offensive rebounding there. Otterbein is running out of time in this game. They're going to have to put together a big run here at the end of that quarter. And maybe cut this down to about, I'd say, 12 to 14 points to feel good about having a chance to come back in the fourth quarter. They're down by 22 at the moment. 23, actually. Stone Rock is fouled by McCourt. Brooke Amert will replace Watchman. Hoshauer back in, as well as Abby Zirkel for Otterbein. Basically the starting 5 out there right now for Otterbein, with the exception of McCourt being in there for the injured Mangold. And that's a Mangold issue that we didn't talk about before. With Cutteridge injured, you've got their other starter, normal starter, that is Kathleen DiCarlo, injured, and now Mangold hurt. That's 3 key players moving forward through the rest of this month that you might not get back. And if this is the Otterbein group, it's going to be tough to see them make a move with the way that Capital is thoroughly dominated this game. Right on cue, that's a big layup from Reagan Stone Rock. 55-29. This should turn some heads in the OAC, and Capital has one more chance at a big statement next weekend, too, when they travel to John Carroll, a team that Capital had here at home. It came down to the last possession. After they were down by over 17 in that game, came back, actually 15, I believe, was the number. They came back to make that a one-possession game with basketball in the last minute and couldn't come up with one shot in that closing second. If they play like they have over the last two games, we'll see how Marietta goes on Wednesday, but they could turn some heads with a big win on the road at John Carroll on the 18th, and that would be the true indicator that this team is going to be one to be reckoned with in the OAC tournament. It's starting to come together for the Crusaders, and they lead 56-29. We'll be right back.
This is a message for all those MBA seekers out there. For the junior exec who'd rather be senior, for the VP yearning to be CEO, and for everyone who'd call their job not just a profession, but a passion. Capital University's MBA program was built exclusively for professionals, experienced faculty, flexible schedules, and classmates you'll soon consider colleagues. Learn more at capital.edu/MBA. The Capital University MBA, for those driven to do more.
Life is good right now at the Capital Center, 56-29. How much can Capital win this game by? Becomes the question at this point as Otterbein is continuing to just struggle. 23, Brooke Amert picks up the foul this time. Capital shooting 47% from the game, 7 of 13 from 3. And setting a tone for game 2 of the doubleheader. Which is obviously the men's game that'll be coming up at the conclusion of this game. Second free throw from Scholes is good. 56-31 now our score. Taking a look, by the way, at Capital with their 7 3-pointers in this game. That's now back-to-back games with 7 3-pointers. That's the first time they've done that all season. McCord can't get the basket to go. Scholes the putback, no good. Rebound collected by Kaylee Cyphers. If Capital makes two more threes, it would mark the season high for them in three-point shots made. And that would match the 8 that they made against Heidelberg if they make one more. And that was 2 games ago. Falling away from the basket, Amert. I don't know how that's not a foul. Scholes is calling for it. Hoshauer drives through traffic and finds a safe area on the floor. Hoshauer working against Linder. Pass off McCord. McCord now to the right wing. Splitting two defenders is Jackson, and then drawing the charge is Erica Linder. Capitals defense has been outstanding. Capital also shooting 53.8% from three. They've had just 2 other games this season where they shot over 50%, 6 for 11 at Muskingum and 4 for 7 against Mount Union. So if they shoot over 58% and have 8 threes, it'd be the best 3-point performance from a number and a percentage standpoint this year. Cyphers, the layup blocked by McCord. Well, McCord is becoming a nice little practice for Olivia Nagy next week. And the shot blocking department. She's been great today. That is her third. Burns is wide open. Whoops. No good from three, though, as Otterbein lucks out. The rebound collected by McCord. Bit of a silence has fallen over the Capital Center as they've led by 25, and Jackson gets a tough shot to go. Otterbein trying to stay in this game. I mentioned they want to get this down to like 14 points or so. They're down by 23. I don't think it's going to happen here in the last 3 minutes, but we'll see. That's only half of the way back, not even. Coach Jeffers taking the air out of the basketball, telling the Crusaders to slow down. Bosch still looking to match her career high with another basket. Instead, it won't be this possession. Amert, tough shot. She's fouled. Capital will stick with this lineup here of Cyphers, Amert, Bosch, Burns, and Linder. Capital's only had 10 players seen the floor. Sam Seck, one of them, will come in now. Allison Roach only played a few minutes in that first half. She played 1 minute and 13 seconds. Cyphers played 3:38 in the first half. Sam Seck played 2:02. Seck comes in for Bosch. And now Reagan Stonerock will also come in for Cyphers. Pass goes into Bauer, who will bring it up. Bauer will be defended by Seck here, basically playing the Caroline Taphorn role of hounding the ball carrier. She does a good job of it. Passes off to Fox. Now Linder pokes it free. Amert comes away with it. Gives it back to Linder. Linder to the basket. She lost it on the way up, and it's going to be a turnover. Linder did a good job with that in the first half with that spinning layup. Tried to do it again, but lost the ball on the way up. It'll be brought across the floor now by Bauer. Haley Bauer still with it and just goes to the basket and gets her first points of the game. She made three threes in the first matchup, and that's her first points in this one. Seck back out to Burns. Burns will slow down once again. 12 minutes left to go in the game. Capital leads by 23. Linder off to Amert. Burns on left wing. 10 to shoot. Looking down low. Now has Seck for three. Yes! The senior Sam Seck with a big shot. Three balls good. And Crusaders lead now 61-35. That matches a season high now with 8 three-pointers made. Stonerock called for the foul. Stonerock picks up her second foul here. Cyphers and Amert will stay out there. This is a big set for Capital. Normally don't have three large players in the game. Actually, that was Seck, not Cyphers. That makes more sense. Amert typically plays the four when she's in, not the three. And that's exactly the lineup here. Bauer gets the layup to go, or the free throw to go after she was fouled on that last layup attempt. She's now up to 3 points. What a statement in this little two-game homestand. Then Capital will go to game three of it tomorrow, or next game, sorry, on Wednesday against Marietta. They have 4 of 7 games at home here at the end of the season in February. Linder trying to draw two defenders. Seck calling for a screen. Drives in, leaves it for Amert, and Amert loses the basketball trying to go post to post. That's a quick possession, too, for Capital. You don't want quick, empty possessions. If you want to come up empty, I mean, you never want to, but if you do come up empty, then you need to at least come to a point where you at least take up 25 seconds of that clock. Schultz's free throw is no good. Otterbein has to make their free throws. They've been good at the line. That's just their second miss, 10 of 12. But they missed both. And now Capital can eat some time here and still have a 2-for-1. Up by 24, but you're not really worried about a 2-for-1 in this situation, but they're probably going to have one just the way the clock works out and at least take away a 2-for-1 from Otterbein. Linder pulls back, drives into the paint, layup, too strong, And the rebound is a jump ball. It's going to stay with Capital, and they have 4 seconds to shoot because that did not hit the rim. Linder will inbound to Burns, an illegal screen called. That's on Reagan Stonerock, and that is Stonerock's third. Ellie Watchman will come on and replaces Reagan Stonerock. Be brought up the floor by Otterbein, Hoschauer, being guarded by Linder. There's a 1 second differential between the shot and game clock. Otterbein's just looking for their best shot. Bauer turns it over, and then Burns is fouled by Jackson. And now Bauer is a little bit slow to get up. She's okay. The third foul on Jackson. Capital goes to the line in the bonus, and it's one of their best free throw shooters in Emma Burns. The numbers aren't great, 74%, but she is someone you want at the line and proving it there, making that first. This quarter will end with Otterbein once again losing the quarter. Capital outscoring them 23-14 in this quarter. Hoschauer misses. Watchman gets the rebound and has 6 seconds to work with. Linder gets it to no one. 0.1 on the clock. It's going to stay with Capital because it was tipped. And this becomes a superfluous hand or inbound pass from Sec. It literally is 0.1 seconds. There's nothing that Capital can do. And they'll pass it in to Watchman. 23-14, Capital with another 23-point quarter. And they lead now 63-37. Fourth quarter frame coming right up next.
I wanted to fly. They said I couldn't. So I built a plane, then a spaceship, then I went to the moon. I invented jazz, hip-hop, rock and roll. Some called it noise. I said it was music. I wrote a letter and sent it by ponies. It didn't get to you fast enough, so I used trucks and ships. But still, they weren't fast enough for me. So I lost the paper and the ink. I sent it by magic. I called it email. I made up new words. Jukebox, bling, Google. And I decided some old words weren't okay to say ever again. The mustache. I tried to bring that back 17 times. I wore knickerbockers and shoulder pads, poodle skirts and flannel. When I came back from World War II, all I had was a t-shirt. So I made that cool. In fact, I invented cool. Who am I? I'm the spirit of youth. It's my job to move the world forward. Pepsi, every generation refreshes the world.
63-37. Capital trying to close this one out. Going back to the Muskingum game, Capital's last 7 quarters of basketball here at home have gone as follows. 27 points in the first quarter against Muskingum. 22, 26, 16, 23, 17, and then 23 again in the third quarter here. That's a pretty good sequence. Defensively, it's been good too as Watchman gets the basket and is fouled. Defensively, they've allowed 8, 14, 18, 24 in the last quarter against Muskingum. 16, 7, and 14. And again, over the last 3 quarters of play, they have outscored their opponents now by 53 points. And after that basket from Watchman and this one from Bosch, it continues to climb. Cassidy Bosch ties a career high with 20 now, a score she set earlier this season. Capital has hit their most three-pointers in a game, tying a mark set against Heidelberg a few games back with 8. One more three and they'll pass that. Basket good by Schultz, and Otterbein goes to full court pressure here. Capital will try to just eat this clock away. Once they break the press, they do. Otterbein has gone back to a man-to-man. They've tried a lot of different things, and nothing has really worked. Watchman, Taphorn on the left wing. Caroline, inside, too high. It's taken away. And at least they were able to eat some time that possession. Time to start chucking threes if you're Otterbein here. Schultz will take a long two instead. And Capital's fine with that. Taphorn will bring it across. Three of the next four for Capital still at home and have a real chance to make some noise and move into that fourth spot with the win today and then just kind of keep hold of it. They got a lot of teams chasing them in the rear view. Pass goes into Amert. Two to shoot. It's going to be a shot clock violation as Watchman just throws it up in the air towards the basket. If that would have gone in, that would have shown you what kind of night it's been for Otterbein. 67-39. Coach Jeffers coaching like it's a two-point game still, as you'd expect, on the sideline. And that was something Jill White had said in our pregame interview. It doesn't really matter what the score is. Coach Jeffers coaches hard and expects you to play hard. 67-41. Again, the 1995 team is here from Capitol, and the banners are right here in front of me, and they speak for themselves here at the Capitol Center. In the 1992-93 season, Capitol went 28-4 and was the national runner-up. The next year, in 93-94, they went 30-1 and were the national champions. And how do you go from those last 2 years of 28-4 with a second place finish and 30-1 with a first place finish? How do you beat that? Well, the 95 team did it. As Burns misses a three, Watchman put back, she's fouled. The 95 team went 33-0. No big deal. En route to a back-to-back national title. And then 2 years later, 96-97, the team went 29-4 and finished in third place. So what a run from the 93 season all the way through to 97. All Americans along the way, including Kerry Ferguson and Jill White and others. And a phenomenal 33-0 season will be celebrated here on the 25th anniversary at the Capitol Center in between games from the women and men's. And there are plenty of people here to cheer them on and give them some props for what was a dominant run in the mid-90s. Haley Bauer makes a three. Oh, they're going to call that a two. Excuse me, 69-43. And Watchman bounce pass over to Burns. Otterbein offense is starting to come to play a little bit here. Three ball from Bosch, no good. That's her first miss in the last two games from outside. Capitol gets the rebound and a reset. Taking this under 7 minutes now, Taphorn passes off to Emma Burns. Emma on the left wing. Pass off Taphorn to shoot, wide open, long two, no good. That's tapped out of bounds by Otterbein, and Capitol will keep possession. And the more I'm looking to my right, the better. Linder replaces Burns now. Linder has played a lot in this game. We're still waiting for that 9-3 that would set a season high. Capitol has had three-pointers, four of them from Cassidy Bosch, two from Burns, and one apiece from second Linder. Breaking some ankles is Linder there, which gets a reaction from the crowd. Now Taphorn is going to be called for a, never mind, it's going to be a block. Thought that was going to be a charge, and instead it's a block on Abby Schultz. And that'll be the rest for Abby Schultz. That's her fifth. Have a good night. Abby Schultz is done. I don't know what this conversation could be about. I guess Coach Knowles is asking how that's a charge, but that's her fifth foul. Let's get her out of here and keep this game moving. Abby Scholes is refusing to leave the floor, and she finally will. Have a good night watching from the bench as Capital continues the dominance, leading by 26 into Watchman. And now Bosch, they're going to call a tie-up. I mean, Cassidy clearly won that, but she missed the shot anyway, so I guess we'll keep her stats better. And it'll be a takeaway for Otterbein now. Down by 26, the Cardinals have 6:18 left to play in what was not their night here at the Capital Center. Hoshauer passing out. And this is now Zirkle with it. Zirkle to McCord. McCord, no good. And Amert catches it out of the air before that gets out of bounds. Taphorn will let the clock tick down here. Under 5:45 now. She takes a shot, no good. Watchman, another offensive rebound, and she'll smartly give it back out to Taphorn. Capital will continue to melt the clock away here. Taphorn driving in left side. Tough shot, no good, and rebounded by Bauer. Taphorn slow to get up on this end of the floor. And Capital is able to win possession back without her playing down a man. Good job defensively. Timeout called by Otterbein. It'll be a 30-second timeout. We'll take a quick one.
This is a message for all those MBA seekers out there. For the junior exec who'd rather be senior. For the VP yearning to be CEO. And for everyone who'd call their job not just a profession, but a passion. Capital University's MBA program was built exclusively for professionals, experienced faculty, flexible schedules, and classmates you'll soon consider colleagues. Learn more at capital.edu/MBA. The Capital University MBA, for those driven to do more.
69-43, Capital by 26. It's been a pretty good day for the Crusaders. Pretty large understatement there, I guess. Capital sticks with mostly starters out there. Actually, it's mostly reserves and Cassidy Bosch. Stone Rock, the two starters in. Linder, Roach, and Cyphers check in for Capital on the offensive side of the floor. Linder looked inside. Behind the back dribble now, gets it to Stone Rock, who's fouled by Horsley. That's Horsley's third as well. Angelia Jackson has four fouls that she's playing with. Taphorn has three, and Stone Rock has three for Capital. Stone Rock to the line, where she has quietly again put together a solid game, as has been her trademark here. Seven points and eight rebounds. Bosch has 20. A double-double for Ellie Watchman, 11 points and 12 rebounds. 10 points for Emma Burns, 8 points for Caroline Taphorn. Burns shooting just 3 for 13 today. Linder has 6 off the bench, 4 from Ombert and 3 from Sec. Cyphers is the only, and Roach, the only two that have come into this game that have not scored points. Maddie Reese will join them now, as Angelia Jackson goes to the line. Linder out, and the freshman Reese replaces her out of Navarre, Ohio. First one is good from Jackson. On the other side for Otterbein, three players with 8 points. Jackson has 7, Bauer has 6. No one in double figures yet. And Bosch comes away with the rebound. Cassidy needs more points to set a career high. She's tied it with 20 in this one. She drives into the corner, kicked out to Reese. Reese to Roach. Roach travels because Cyphers cut inside there when Roach went to pass. And she had to either shoot or do something with it there to get rid of the basketball. 70-44 on the left wing, back into the corner. Looking inside now. And Jackson, make that McCord has it, working on Cyphers. Basket's good. And this is some good momentum for Otterbein moving into the rest of their games this season. But other than that, not much. Free throw is no good from McCord. Cyphers gets the rebound. We will bring that post-game ceremony honoring the 95 team to you live here at the Capitol Center, so stay with us. It'll be a little bit of a different post-game show as we have to get to the pregame show for the men's after the turnover here for Otterbein. After the announcement of that honoring of that team, we will have the post-game show, the Byers Airport Subaru post-game show. And it'll basically be just a quick wrap-up after that to get the set up here over to Charlie in the men's game. And hopefully Capital can go 2-for-2 tonight. Jossie Kaiser checking in for Capital. Reese, and a screen there from Bosch on Hoshauer. A hard screen, to say the least. Kaiser had two threes in the game against Muskingum. That fouls against Cassidy Bosch, I guess. Bosch laughing. And pretty good reaction, I guess. Well, the players play hard to the very end, and the officials are expected to officiate hard till the very end as well. Jackson on the layup. She's fouled by Bosch. That's now four on Cassidy. And at this point, probably we'll just get her out of the game to preserve her from fouling out. Free throw is good from Jackson. Actually, Coach Jeffers is now motioning to Cassidy, you have one foul left. That's your fourth. So she's going to stay out there. Offensive rebound collected now by Otterbein after the miss. Bauer. Pass goes inside to McCord. McCord on the left side of the rim is good on the layup. And it's 70-51. Well, Otterbein has made this a little bit more respectable. Actually, 70-49. Excuse me, the score was already added. A full timeout called by Capital as they regroup here for the final 2:57 here at the Capitol Center.
Capital University presents The Good Guarantee. The Good Guarantee promises families who work for nonprofits or in public service will never have to pay more than 50% tuition based on their total amount of financial aid. This includes your talent, merit, and need-based aid. You can live on campus or at home. It's renewable for up to 8 semesters, and you can study any major and minor. Current students can apply too. You qualify if you or your spouse or your parent or guardian work for a nonprofit or public service organization, and you are a full-time undergrad. Because we want to create purposeful people, courageous community, and hopeful humanity. The world needs more good. The world needs you. You invest in others, we invest in you. For more information, visit capital.edu/good-guarantee.
Putting the finishing touches on this one, 2:57 to play. Capital sticks with the same five out of the timeout, but will be making some more changes here as I see Demi Brewer and Nancy Siegel getting ready to come on for Capital. Kaiser gives off to Roach. Roach back to Reese now. Reese driving baseline. Reese is fouled. Maddie Reese will head to the free throw line. Reese's 9 for 12 from the field this season at the free throw line, which would not be from the field. Losing it here at the end of this one. Reese's first free throw is good. A very young backcourt for Capital. They have a lot of young freshmen behind the veteran group that will all turn to seniors next year, juniors, upperclassmen. You've got freshman guards of Maddie Reese, Nancy Siegel, Demi Brewer, Erica Linder, and Natalie Gladia as well. All freshmen and all guards. That's a deep group. And they do have quite a few young freshmen as well. They have Gabby Ledbetter and Kaylee Cyphers as freshman centers, I guess you'd call them, or forwards. Addie Becker will come on next for Capital as Siegel has checked in with Demi Brewer. Becker replaces Cyphers. And the senior getting some playing time here against Otterbein. Pass goes in to Kaiser. And let's see how this group does with breaking the press. That's not a good start. Maddie Reese with the travel. Nonetheless, some valuable playing time here for these younger folks in this situation. Pass goes into Jackson. Jackson gives off to Bauer for three. Yes. Haley Bauer knocks in the triple. Otterbein within 18, but they're just not going to have enough time. 2:02 to play. Nice move there from Demi Brewer, and then it was taken away by Hoshauer. Hoshauer driving in, and an illegal screen is called against Otterbein. That's going to go against number 25, Danielle Horsley. That is her fourth. Brewer gets a screen from Becker. Becker looks left, looks right, gives off now to Siegel. Siegel gives off to Kaiser. Kaiser back now to Reese. Reese on the left wing drives into the paint, and she traveled, lost her foot again. .132 left to play. Pass goes inside. Jackson throws up a miss. Becker gets the rebound and gives off to Brewer. On left wing now. Brewer has Siegel under the basket coming outside. It goes to Becker. Becker, backdoor pass to Reese. Layup's good. That's good two-man game right there. Maddie Reese gets on the scoreboard now at four after those two free throws. Gets the first basket of the game for herself. We're under the final minute of this one. Capital will move to 6-6. A big win for them to move into sole possession of fourth place. Otterbein falls back into a group of three at 5-7, tied for fifth, sixth, and seventh. Timeout called, and this was supposed to be a rolling timeout just to get some subs in for Capital, but they called a 30-second timeout instead. They finally break up this Otterbein huddle as Coach Jeffers trying to get this moving here so we can get on to our post-game festivities. .40 seconds left to play. Brewer on the left wing. Passes off to Siegel. Ledbetter will clear out, and now it goes to Reese. Reese dropping it in, and it's taken away by McCord. One last possession here for Otterbein, and then Capital can dribble out the final few seconds of yet another victory here at the Capitol Center. A block by Becker. The putback is good. 17 seconds left for Capitol to dribble out. And improve now to 7-4 here at home, 11-8 overall, and 6-6 in conference play, as for some reason a shot there from Brewer. Rebounded by Otterbein, and that'll be the end of the ball game. A statement made tonight by the Crusaders as they defeat Otterbein 74-58. And again, a reminder, said it a few times, so I'm sure you all know, but the women's team from 1995 is going to be honored tonight. And that's coming up in moments here from the Capitol Center. So stay with us here. We will keep this live as we have a different type of post-game show here tonight for the Byers Airport Subaru post-game show. As first the women will celebrate at half court, and then the women's team will come out from 1995 here. We'll cut down to the public address of that, and it looks like the cheerleaders are lining up for that as well. So we will cut to our public address for our post-game festivities. Stay with us here at the Capitol Center.
Crusaders had much of the roster returned for the 94-95 season. And to no one's surprise, they had very similar results. Like a one runaway train, the Crusaders steamrolled the competition all the way into the NCAA tournament. It was business as usual. Capital never left the state of Ohio in its second championship run and played four of its six tournament games in alumni gymnasium with wins of 24 points, 34, and 15 twice. It started to get serious in the round of the final four. The Crusaders rallied from behind to defeat St. Thomas University by 9 points, earning a second straight trip to the national championship. On its own floor, in front of the Cap faithful, the Crusaders once again had to overcome a deficit, but would not be deterred. On March 18, 1995, the Crusaders defeated Wisconsin-Oshkosh 59-55 to win its second straight national championship and become the first team to go undefeated in the season.
Thank you.
So a special edition of our Byers Airport Subaru postgame show as we honor the 94-95 national championship team. I mentioned their records during the game, but again, a 33-0 season to finish a back-to-back national championship here in the mid-90s and celebrating their 25th anniversary here at Capitol and talking to the current players as they head off the court here. And a pretty cool ceremony after a dominant win by the women's team here, 74-58. Cassidy Bosch ties a career high with 20 points to lead the Crusaders here tonight. Next up is Marietta. That's on Wednesday here from the Capitol Center. That's a 7 o'clock start, back to our normal schedule. So we'll be here for the Freshies pregame show at 6:30 p.m. Eastern time. For now, we will sign off and then sign right back on. Charlie Danis will bring you the men's game here in game two of our doubleheader as Capitol will go for the Otterbein sweep. I'm Julie Bloomfield. Thanks again for tuning in and stay with us for game two.
Hello and good evening, everyone. We are coming to you from the Capitol Center as we get set for another presentation of Crusaders men's basketball here on the Capitol Sports Network. I'm Charlie Dana. So glad that we could have you along for the ride. This is game two of tonight's Capitol basketball doubleheader as the Crusaders are playing their longtime rivals, the Cardinals. Earlier tonight, we had the women's teams of both schools go at it. And it was a 74-58 win for the Crusaders as they were able to take care of business tonight against the Cardinals. A big win for the women's team, as you heard it here on athletics.capital.edu. Jimmy Bloomfield providing you with the play-by-play of that game. Again, a 74-58 win over Otterbein tonight. And coming up later on in the Freshies pregame show, we'll go over the stats of that game as the women's team was able to chalk up another win during the 2019-2020 campaign. So now we turn our attention to the men's game tonight. Men's team coming off of a rather impressive win the other night on Wednesday evening. They welcomed in the Muskies, and they were able to take care of business against the Muskies by a final of 76-61. Leading the way for Capitol offensively in that game was Reed Bradfield. Bradfield had 20 points. He shot 8 of 15 from the field. Also went 4 of 5 from the foul line. Grabbed 4 rebounds as well. He was one of 4 players that tallied double digits in scoring for the Crusaders. Giahaya had 12. Tyler Schreck, he had 15. Nearly had another double-double as well, as he was able to pull down 8 rebounds. And finally, Cam Caldwell, he had 10 points. Also, a good game for Joe Hartman. Didn't do a lot of scoring, only had 6 points, but the center from Cincinnati was able to pull down 8 rebounds. The leading scorer for Muskingum was Marcus Dempsey. He poured in 31, but it was not enough, as Capitol was able to get the win over the Muskies. So with that win, Capitol improved to 10-8 overall, 6-5 within OAC play. They find themselves all alone in fourth place within the conference standings, and that's very important going forward because Capitol, heading into the OAC tournament, would like to have that extra game or that extra day to work with, that extra off day, I should say, as they head into the OAC tournament. Remember, the top 4 seeds within the OAC tournament, they get a mini bye. They do not have to play in the first round. They let all the other teams duke it out for the right to play the top 4 seeds within the tournament. Right behind Capitol, John Carroll, Heidelberg, and Wilmington, all 5-6 within conference play to begin tonight. So Capitol looking to keep things rolling. They have won back-to-back games, wins over Ohio Northern and Muskingum. They've also won 3 out of their last 4. We have talked all season long about how this Capitol men's basketball team has been trying to find consistency during the 2019-2020 campaign. And they're trying to do something for the first time all year. And that would be win 3 straight games. They have won back-to-back games during multiple occurrences of this 2019-2020 campaign. But they have yet to win 3 straight games. They will get that opportunity tonight as they welcome in the Cardinals, who, oh, by the way, is coached by a guy who used to be on the Capitol sideline as an assistant coach to head man Damon Goodwin. This is the first season for Andy Winters as head coach of the Otterbein Cardinals. And so far this year, Otterbein 6-12 overall, 3-8 within OAC play. That is third to last in the conference standings. But as I always say about this game every single season, throw out the records, throw out the statistics. Weird things tend to happen in this game between the Cardinals and the Crusaders. It's just the nature of the rivalry between these two crosstown foes who happen to call Central Ohio home. Capitol located here in Bexley, Ohio. Otterbein, meanwhile, residing in Westerville. So we are getting set for the renewal of a long-time rivalry within the Ohio Athletic Conference between the Cardinals and the Crusaders. We are just getting started here on the Freshies pregame show. When we come back, we'll take a look around the OAC and also recap the win for the women's team earlier tonight as they took care of business against Otterbein by a final of 74-58. This is the Freshies pregame show here on your home for Crusaders men's basketball, athletics.capital.edu.
Lunch, the most unappreciated meal of the day, which is why we at Freshie are screaming from the rooftops, let there be lunch. And no, not a sad sandwich at your desk. We're talking a flavorful Tex-Mex burrito after a brisk walk, or a nutritious Kale Caesar with your work bestie. So let's do our minds, bodies, and taste buds a favor, and let there be lunch. Download the game-changing new Freshie app to have your food ready, or order at freshie.com.
Army ROTC is one of the best leadership courses in the country and can be a part of your college curriculum. As a potential or current student at Capital University, learning to become a leader will make your college experience even richer and prepare you for the future. Capital Army ROTC can provide scholarships and many more benefits to those who enroll, but the biggest benefit will be experienced firsthand after joining. For more information on Capital Army ROTC, testimonials, and an in-depth look at what the program can offer you, go to www.capital.edu/ROTC.
This is a message for all those MBA